Hello, everyone. Welcome to Spanning the Need with Anthony Spano, and now I have OEA President Scott DiMauro. How you doing tonight, Scott?
I'm doing well, Tony. How are you?
Doing well. Making sure that just we staying safe and hunkering down.
Yeah, same here.
So, Scott, we're going to talk a little bit about education and the future that where we're going with this pandemic. So it gives us an opportunity to just kind of talk about what's going on and what's going from where we are, where we were in March to where we are now. So if you could just give us a little background of where you're from and what you have done in the past, that would be appreciative for everyone to hear.
Yeah, sure. So I've spent most of my career teaching in the Worthington School District, which is a suburb of Columbus. Grew up outside of Akron, but lived in Central Ohio since not long after graduating from college. I went to Miami University and got my master's at Ohio State. Got involved in the union from a pretty, you know, early age. My first year teaching in public schools, I was actively involved. And, you know, just found that the union was a great way to stay connected with colleagues and found that there's just a lot of collective power that can happen when you're working together. So over the previous 7 years, I've been an OEA officer. I was full-time vice president for 6 years and then got elected last year at this time as OEA president. So I'm just finishing my first year as well.
What are your expectations going through this pandemic? I mean, we've done a lot of different avenues of school being canceled for the rest of the year. Some people talk about reopening schools in the next month, but at the same time, as the governor has mentioned, that there's nothing that he's going to do to restart the schools for this basically the end of spring from this school year.
Yeah, I mean, so we know that this has been a situation where adaptability, flexibility has been the name of the game. We have seen our members across the state, and we have members, by the way, both in higher education as well as in pre-K through 12, having to adapt really, really quickly to changing circumstances. You know, our schools were not built for remote learning. But because of this emergency, you know, we've had to move into that. And people have been doing amazing work. We're getting tremendously positive feedback from parents all over the place because people are recognizing the teachers are stepping up with creativity and more than anything else, they're just showing how much they care about kids. So it looks different in different places. And it depends on the resources of a school district. Depends on how much internet access the kids have, depends on whether or not they're one-to-one devices for students. Frankly, it depends a lot on the kind of parental support the kids have at home. So in some places, you know, they've just pretty much moved to an online learning kind of platform. In other cases, it's teachers are spending a lot of time just making phone calls, doing wellness checks to make sure that the kids are okay. In all situations, trying to do the best we can to make sure learning is continuing, even though circumstances are really, really challenging.
And we know just from watching the news and talking with local people that the schools are still open. Kids aren't there, but a lot of the schools are distributing food to a lot of in-need families. And how has that become a new thing now? Because, well, you close the schools, but you still have families that are in need because of this crisis.
You froze there for a second, but I think I know where you're going with the question. So, you know, what this pandemic has done, what the shutdown has done, is that it's put a spotlight on deep levels of inequity that existed long before this whole thing happened. In one area where we know that there's a lot of inequity has to do with food insecurity. We know that statewide, about one out of every five students comes from a food insecure home where they depend on school source for their breakfast or their lunch or both, and in some cases, maybe even dinner, maybe even weekend and summer feeding programs. So schools across the state have had to step up and make sure that we're attending to the basic fundamental needs of students. We have to make sure that Maslow's hierarchy is taken care of before we can go, you know, higher and deeper in terms of other types of learning. And so the creative work that's happened as far as meal distribution, we see districts that are setting multiple meal sites up in different parts of the district. In some places, you've got, you know, long lines of kids and families that are trying to get that food. In other places, they're using bus routes as a way to distribute food, as well as to distribute assignments and to collect assignments and things like that. So again, it looks different everywhere because of the resources. The higher the level of poverty, the more of a struggle this is. And the sad thing is, the deeper the gap gets them between the haves and the have-nots.
And I think, and just my mom is an aide at Champion Local School Districts in Trumbull County in Ohio, and she's volunteered her time to help distribute those. But the difference, the way that we used to distribute it, is a totally different way with masks and gloves and putting it at the doorstep. And she said that the need is tremendous and something that she would have never thought. So how is that funding that we take from the normal schools, the everyday function, does that work in funding these types of meals, or is this coming from an outside source in a lot of these school districts?
So the funding primarily comes through the federal government, Department of Agriculture, you know, school lunch, school breakfast program. And the good thing that happened early on is that states and the federal government collaborated to say we need to waive some of the traditional rules so that, for example, a parent can pick up a meal. It doesn't have to be directly handed to a child. And that meals don't have to be distributed in school. They can you know, come up with other creative ways. But you just mentioned one of the realities, one of the challenges in all of this. Our cafeteria workers, our bus drivers, a lot of our paraprofessionals like your mom, you know, they're having to interact with members of the public. And so having PPE is really critical. We know that there have been, you know, big outbursts of cases, you know, concentrations of COVID cases in Trumbull County and Mahoning County, as well as other places around the state. And so we have to be really, really vigilant in protecting the health and safety of our members, who are a lot more vulnerable to contracting the coronavirus than the students themselves are. But we know students are big carriers of the virus, and so that's why there's all kinds of concern there. But yeah, health and safety is at the very top of our list of priorities, and then doing what we can to address the needs, especially the needs of kids.
And let's follow up that there was a study done in both Germany and China, and they said that children are more likely to spread the disease than adults, which was a pretty interesting study that came out today that we talk about. Right now, we are not in school. The academic year is not over, but it'll all be done from distant learning. So how does that affect going back to school in the fall, where we already have all spring sports canceled for the OHSA, and we have a lot of summer field trips canceled, and a lot of them, no graduation on most of these, but some are being very, having great ideas on how to do that with social distancing.
Yeah. I mean, the reality is no one knows what the fall's gonna look like yet. We're still, you know, 3 months, 3 to 4 months away from the normal scheduled start of the school year. And, you know, it kind of remains to be seen what's gonna happen with these virus numbers. I think most people agree, though, that until we get a vaccine and or we get, you know, a reliable treatment and a lot more testing, that there's going to be so much uncertainty that everyone, including schools, are going to have to err on the side of caution as they plan. And so you mentioned that students are carriers. The other thing that's been fascinating, I think, and very, very scary, is to see what's happened with these outbreaks in a couple of Ohio large state prisons, where you do have widespread testing, and you have incredibly large numbers of inmates and staff who have no symptoms, but they're carriers of the virus and they're helping to spread it. So that's with adults, and if we're seeing from other countries, that kids are even more likely to be asymptomatic but still carriers. That means that a lot of the adults that work in schools, and I'm hearing this more and more from members, who feel that they have risk factors because of their age or because of underlying health conditions, they're really concerned about what things are going to look like if and when we go back to, you know, schools being open in a way that they've traditionally been open. What we're saying at OEA is don't open schools unless it's safe to open schools. I think we have to be really cautious, both from a safety standpoint and also from just a practical reality standpoint, to do halfway measures to say, you know, somehow we're going to still have kids in class, but we're going to space desks 6 feet apart. You know, when you've got 25 kids in a classroom, that's just impossible. So how do you actually make that work is a really, really good question. And we're working with state authorities on trying to collaborate with some guidance on it.
And that rolls back to, basically, it was one March, I think it was 13th or 14th, we've been 45, 50 days from the governor saying, it's go home for the schools. And teachers had to basically change the way they teach, change the way they do stuff. I hear from a lot of parents that, as you know, today is a Teacher Appreciation Day and Appreciation Week. So you've seen on social media a lot of different people thanking teachers for what they do. How have some of the teachers handled the pandemic from teaching from home? Some have probably are more younger, have done the technology, and you have some of the teachers that have been there a long time that may not know technology, but everyone has professional development, and we have great teachers. So how is that affecting them now, and how are they dealing with this during the pandemic?
Well, as you can imagine, teachers run the gamut, just like students run the gamut, just like the population runs the gamut in terms of people's, you know, comfort level with different technology platforms. We were thrown into this with virtually no advance notice. The governor made his announcement, I think, on March 12th or 13th, and then it was the end of school on March 16th that schools were closed. So there was no time to plan. We will have one of the things that at least I hope everybody's paying attention to is that in order for distance learning to work, not only do we have to have internet access and devices that can be reliable, in both students and teachers. But we have to make sure that there is much better training and preparation for the teachers that are expected to use that technology. We've got time to do it. We've got to make sure that districts are really taking that time to provide that training. And even before that, you know, what everybody should be doing at the end of this school year, and I think it's actually a good idea if schools, you know, end maybe a week earlier than they would have otherwise, but take time to really do a serious assessment of what's worked, what hasn't worked, what are the needs that still exist, how do we look at that from an educator perspective, and how do we look at that especially from a student perspective, so that we can go into the next school year with a plan that makes sense, and we're not being thrown into it, you know, by surprise, like is what happened tomorrow.
And I think that brings up a great point: is school years are coming to an end. A lot of school districts get funding from the state, so you may have a school system that's in the black now going forward, but now the governor just made a massive announcement that he's going to be cutting almost nearly $1 billion from the state budget, which includes $300 million from K-12 funding and additional $110 from other educational line items. How is that going to affect schools moving forward? I mean, especially through the summer. I mean, that's only for 2 months. So what's going to happen in another 2 or 4 months? So that'll get us through May and June, where a lot of the fiscal budgets will be coming to an end in July and August and September. So you're looking at that different avenue of depending on what school district you are. So what's going to happen moving forward, where income is just going to drop from what the governor said? So how's that going to affect this?
Well, I tell you what, we're not going to be able to, parents and communities aren't going to be able to count on being able to go back to work unless they can count on their kids going back to safe schools. It's going to be really hard to count on safe schools for our kids and for our communities if we have massive cuts to our budgets. And while I understand state leaders have to make really, really difficult choices because, you know, the resources just aren't there because so many people are out of work and the economy is in such bad shape right now, we have to make sure that we're prioritizing education. This is our future. And one of the things that we're working really hard on right now is to put as much pressure as we can on Congress, because it's only the federal government that really has the ability to generate the resources that we need. We're asking for $175 billion in additional federal relief across the country, targeted to K-12 education as part of a larger $500 billion package of relief to states and local communities. We think it's going to take those kinds of resources to make sure that we don't lose a generation of kids, which is what we're at risk of seeing happen if we don't come up with resources to meet the kinds of needs that we just talked about.
Well, and we also were starting to look at K-12 in some of the news media starting to pick up that school districts are looking at cutting costs. There was one superintendent, they made an announcement that he was leading by example, taking a $30,000 pay cut to help with the budget. And that's starting to see the trend where other superintendents are doing that. So I think you're going to see that it's going to be very difficult for schools to be fully funded if we go into the fall and this is still where we are now, where there's more cuts coming down. I mean, how do you think funding will be replenished if it's not coming from the federal government?
Well, it's going to be really tough. Now, the state does have a $2.7 billion rainy day fund, which the governor has chosen not to touch yet. It is sure raining in Ohio right now. So we're going to have to draw down that rainy day fund, and we're going to have to commit a big chunk of those resources to K-12 education as well as higher education. We're going to have to keep putting pressure on the federal government. At the local level, we're not sure exactly how this is going to play out in every school district. We don't know how the cuts are going to be distributed. That hasn't been announced yet. We still have to wait and see how the federal dollars that are coming in are going to be distributed. We know that districts that get a lot of Title I funds are going to get more federal funds than districts that don't, which is good. I mean, you know, those are higher poverty districts. But it's going to be a big challenge. It's going to be a lot of difficult choices, and we're advocating that as any of those choices are being made, we have to make sure that education is a priority. When local cuts happen, we also have to make sure that we're protecting collective bargaining, because, you know, you can't have one person at the top, a superintendent or a school board, making unilateral decisions about cuts without engaging with local unions to talk about how all that stuff's going to navigate. I think if we work together and we collaborate and we rely on the collective bargaining process, we're going to have a lot better outcomes than if, you know, a few people are making those decisions.
And I think that brings up the point is, how with funding, and you're looking at smaller classes to, I think the governor was looking at having some students come on a Monday, Wednesday, and another come on Tuesday, Thursday. How is that going to affect, what are some of the options that we have? One article that I reference is from Burlington, North Carolina, and it said that three things are going to happen. Scheduled days home, there'll be students that schedule home, and then some that will come, and then vice versa, more online learning and lots of hand washing.
Yeah. No, it's going to, life is going to be different. And I think that things like, you know, not having a mob of 800 kids, you know, eating in the cafeteria all at the same time, I think people recognize that that's just not realistic. I do think, though, that there are some modifications that some people are thinking about, like what you just talked about, a split session schedule, that we're going to have to really think through the implications of that. If we're seeing major budget cuts, you can't have it both ways. You can't say that, well, we're going to maintain small classes and we're going to, you know, modify schedules and we're going to have some kids come in the morning and other kids come in the afternoon, if you don't have enough teachers to cover all those classes, if you don't have enough staff, bus drivers to move the kids in and out. So the more budget cuts happen, the fewer options there are for how we move forward and conduct school. That's another reason why we got to make sure that we fight for every single dollar we can get.
Well, and I think that brings back to that there was in an article, it said that the CDC has guidelines for schools to go back, but they were vague. And they told you to look at your local health department for help. So what does that look like when CDC says 6 feet apart, you're looking at 30 people in a class, but you can't spread out the desks? And I think that's where that online learning may help.
Yeah, and that's actually what we've been saying to the state of Ohio as well, that we need the Ohio Department of Health to issue very, very clear parameters in terms of what are the minimum requirements in order for schools to be open and still protect health and safety of school staff and students. And then you're going to have flexibility at the local level to figure out within the resources that are available what is actually feasible and what's not. I think that there's going to be, in a lot of cases, this idea of a halfway approach may just not be feasible because the resources aren't there. We'll see what happens.
Well, and I think the biggest is the unknown. We don't know what's going to be coming down the road. We may have a vaccine in 2 months, 4 months, or 8 months. So I guess the big question is where do we go from here?
Right. I think you know, I've already said up, but I'll kind of highlight a couple of things that we've been advocating for. We need time to assess where we are. We need to focus on equity, directing resources and support where it's needed the most. We need to make sure that we are prioritizing health and safety. We need to make sure that decisions aren't being made collaboratively and honoring the collective bargaining process. And in all of that, I think we just have to recognize that you've got people that are working really, really hard, doing the very best they can, and we all have to give each other some grace, you know, as we continue working through some of the
Well, challenges. I appreciate you taking the time. You up for any Q&As?
I'm happy to respond to any questions, yeah.
Okay, so here was a question brought in from a teacher. How will DeWine, we have about 5 minutes, so about 5-6 minutes total. So first one is, how will DeWine's decision to cut education funding affect the class sizes, small or students more spread apart? I think we answered that a little bit, but if you want to go into
it. I think we did. I think the reality is you can't have smaller classes if you have a shortage of funds that require larger class sizes. You know, if you have to lay off teachers because you don't have enough money, then you're going to have larger classes, and it probably increases the likelihood that you have to continue remote learning instead of bringing kids back to school.
And I think it also
really bad news for parents that are trying to get back to work.
Exactly, right? Where they need to go to daycare, or they need to go to school because they need to go to work. This one was, I think we talked about this, but what would OEA say something about massive cuts to education in the state made by DeWine this afternoon? Seems like Ohio's education, its students have to pay the cost first during COVID-19.
Yeah, I mean, it's a sad day. Coming on Teacher Appreciation Day really is especially, you know, a bitter pill to swallow. We still have to wait and see how exactly those cuts are going to be implemented. It's too early to know inside any particular district what's going to happen. We do know that in the aggregate, there's actually more additional money coming in from the CARES Act than there are in that $300 million worth of cuts. but so much of that depends on distribution, depends on timing, and you know, the cuts are going to be painful. It's disappointing. We have to fight for every dollar we can get. The body that is in best position to provide relief is the Congress. And I think everybody should be contacting Senator Portman and Senator Brown, who I know is on our side on this issue, but Senator Portman especially, and all the members of our House delegation, to encourage them to provide significant funding relief for states and school districts.
And then I think this may be the last question. What are some of the policies OEA is supporting to make sure that all online distant learning is consistent with the threat of continuing long-term closures due to COVID-19? How can the workload be evenly distributed through districts where some are grading for everyone? Right now, it's a giant free-for-all in some districts.
I mean, it starts with ensuring that every educator and every student, and with that, every family, has access to high-speed internet, has access to Wi-Fi, and has a device that's reliable that they can use for learning. And I know that it's really challenging, especially if you've got families with multiple kids, and you know, parents are trying to juggle all kinds of pressures, but you gotta start with technology access first and direct resources. And again, federal government has a role to play here. And then we have to make sure that schools and teachers have the training that they need to make the best use of those resources. One thing that we've learned though through all of this is there is no substitute for the kind of support, the kind of nurturing support that only can happen in that relationship between the teacher or the other education professional and the student in school. This is why, you know, our hearts are breaking when we hear about so many kids that have just kind of fallen off the grid through this time of remote learning. You know, we try to reach out to them, we're calling all the time, we home visits, but in some cases, because it just isn't the kind of support that the kids need, we're seeing some kids that are falling behind in a very significant way. And so we have to continue to work in partnership with other agencies, in partnership with families, to first make sure the basic needs are met, and then address those technology issues and give teachers the tools they need to be successful.
Well, I appreciate you stopping by, I should say, in your house. Hopefully your family is healthy and safe, and we say that to everyone out there, and we appreciate you coming by, Scott, and I hope we can do this again when everything hopefully is in, we're not hunkering down and we can enjoy outside, and which we still can, just 6 feet distance.
Anytime, Tony, and I want to just commend you for the great work that you do with your foundation and the incredible difference that you make in the Mahoning Valley, so keep up the good work.
I appreciate it. Scott, always a pleasure. Take care. Have a safe night. And happy Teacher Appreciation Day.
Hey, thanks. Have a good night.